Any questions from the yesterday's class? Anybody would like to pose any question or get clarify your doubt or something? Anybody has any question? Hello.
Hello, sir.
Okay, so today let me start the another basic fundamentals of the soil mechanics. So that is a little bit on clay mineralogy. So most of the things will be clear to you all. So let us try to understand a bit about the clay mineralogy. So first of all, just try to recall from your concepts of the soil mechanics. So can you list out what are the different clay minerals that you have dealt with in your soil mechanics?
So montmorillonite, illite, kaolinite.
Yeah, so one is kaolinite. So then illite, so then montmorillonite. So then any other clay mineral? So there are several clay minerals. Example, so mica, chlorite, a few. So on and so forth. So there is a big list of different clay minerals. So first of all, so from the yesterday's class it is clear. So clay particles are also called as a Faraday particles, whose the particle size starts from the 2 microns onward. And the inherent attribute of these clay minerals is, so they have a negative charge. Almost every clay mineral has a negative charge. So this charge is because of the isomorphous substitution of cations. So that was happening at crystal structure level. Okay. So now, but another important thing that when we talk about any clay mineral, that normally we discuss is the development of diffuse double layer. So development of diffuse double layer. So this simply is also called as a DDL. So diffused double layer. So can anybody able to explain what it is and how it is forming and where it is forming on the clay?
Sir, hydrogen ion of water attached with the negative charge of the clay on the surface of clay, so that they form the diffuse double layer.
So they form the diffuse double layer. Okay. So why it is called as a diffuse double layer? So there are three terminology here: diffuse, double layer. So what do you mean by what which is diffusing? And why it is called as a double layer? So first of all, can be able to see the layers and the clay particle, because the clay particle maximum size itself is 2 micron, which is not visible for the naked eye. So then how can we say that there is a formation of the two layers on the clay surface? Yes, please. Any answer? So these are the fundamentals of the soil mechanics only. I'm not asking anything out of the context of the soil mechanics. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So any answer? Why it is called as a fused layer?
So when we add water to the clay, it solved the clay negative and bipolar structure of the water, and it formed a strong atmosphere layer on which the water is very large. Then as more water added, it increases. And as it moved away, then the force of attraction on the clay decreases and it closes like the water.
Okay. To some extent, yeah. Okay, so let us try to understand first. See, I'm taking a simple clay particle. So normally we always designate clay particle with flaky shape. So this is the flaky shape. So this is highly exaggerated one. So at the edge, so there is a positive charge, while on the surface, on either side of the particle, there is a negative charge. So this everyone knows. I don't need to reiterate on this point. So this is a negative charge. While the negative charge exists on every clay particle. Okay. So this negative charge is because of the isomorph substitution, so which is happening at the crystal structure level. Now the first thing is that, so whenever there is a charge, so this charge always try to get neutralized by attracting the opposite charge of ions. So on the surface, there is a strong negative layer. So this strong negative layer attracts, so right adjacent to it, a positive layer of ions. So while this ions could be of anything, so it could be ions in essence, your sodium ions, calcium ions, potassium ions, lithium ions, so on and so forth. Okay, but they have to be positive cations, not the anions, because anions have a negative. So a negative, they repel each other. By a negative and positive, they attract each other. So therefore, this negative charge always tries to attract one layer of the positive ions. One layer of positive ions. Why? This adherence or attachment is so strong, even if you put this clay particle in the oven, or other way around, even if this soil is exposed to elevated temperature, we cannot able to remove so this layer of the positive cations. Okay, so that means the electrochemical force overcoming the thermal force. Thermal force is when you are exposing to the elevated temperature, while the adherence is because of the electrochemical forces. So that means you need to apply some other force which overcomes the electrochemical forces. So this was the first invention by the person called as a Stern. So therefore it is called as a Stern layer. Stern was the first person who hypothesized that there is a one layer of positive cations which are very strongly adhered to the each and every clay particle. So that's why it is named as Stern layer. Alright. This is the very first layer. But even after attracting the first layer of the cations, will the charge gets neutralized fully? So the other attract any other cations or maybe few, maybe even anions also. So there are attraction of another cations until the entire charge gets neutralized. So here negative also, don't expect only positive. So the attraction continues until the entire charge gets neutralized. So this is the total thickness of the layer. So this comprises of the very first layer, that is one, called as a strand layer, while this is another layer. So the together they are called as a diffuse double layer. But how the diffuse is coming? Diffuse means if you look at from the edge of the clay particle where the charge is becoming the zero, so this is the point of zero charge. So this the layer of attraction diffuses in a particular way. So that is why it is called as a diffusion of the charge. Diffusion of the charge. So it is there from the both sides, from the up and bottom side. Okay, so this is how the total thickness of these molecules or ions so is called as a diffused double layer. Double means there is a one strand layer and another adsorbed layer. This also called as a, the phenomenon can also be called as a adsorption. Adsorption. So adsorption is typically attributed to the electrochemical phenomenon or together with the charge. Adsorption occurs when there is a presence of the charge or when there is an electrochemical forces. So there is an additional terminology that is called as a absorption. There is an adsorption and there is an absorption. Absorption means simple dissolution of any salt in the water in a simple way. So there could be other meanings also. So you can look at any chemistry book or any other book. For example, if you take the crystals of a sugar or a salt and if you add them in the water, so after some time they get dissolved. That process is called as a, so that process typically can be referred to as absorption. While if there is an adherence of the molecules or ions on the clay particle, so because of the electrochemical forces, so that is called as a adsorption typically. Typically adsorption. Okay. Now here, so these are different variety of ions. Different variety of ions. Now when you talk about the ions, say for example, this could be a sodium ion or calcium ion or potassium ion or lithium ion or aluminium ion, so on and so forth. So on and so forth. Okay. So this cannot be a single ion. However, the single ions also may possible if these clay particles are immersed in a particular chemical solution. Immersed in, say for example, I am immersing this entire clay particle in sodium chloride solution. So in that case, you can hypothesize that so this formation of the diffusion layer predominantly contains sodium ions. Okay, suppose if the clay particles are immersed in calcium rich solution, then instead of the sodium, so we can say so the adherence is because of the calcium ions. Adherence is because of the calcium ions. So this is called as the influence of ionic solution. So this is called as the influence of the ionic solution. Your ionic solution maybe a sodium chloride or sodium sulfate, potassium chloride or potassium sulfate or calcium chloride or any other solution. So wherever you put your clay particles in that solution. So suppose if you look at the ionic solution, so the each ionic solution has its own characteristics. So the behavior of the sodium chloride ionic solution is different than the calcium chloride. So that's how the ionic solution can able to influence the formation of the thickness of the diffusion double layer. Okay, that's why if you read any soil mechanics book, you may see that one of the factors that can influence the thickness of the diffusion double layer, this is the summation of these two is called as a thickness of diffusion double layer. So this is typically I think represented with 1 upon k. you look at any soil mechanics book, you'll find a formula 1 upon k. Okay, so this k is the function of lot of things. So one of the functions the impact is the ionic strength. Why? If you look at further close, the each ion has its own valency. So for example, sodium has a single valency, calcium has a double valency, potassium has a single valency, lithium, I think, if I'm not wrong, is a 4 valency, while aluminium has a 3 valency. So now if the valency differs, so do they have any kind of the influence on the formation or the thickness of diffusion double layer? The answer is yes. So there is a influence of valency on the thickness of the double layer. So instead, one impacting factor is ionic strength. The second one is valency of the solution. Valency of the solution. Now, which valency has more impact on the formation of the diffusion double layer? For example, if you take a single valency, sodium, so this has a lot of attraction or lot of affinity to water. So therefore, whenever there is a single valency ions or ionic solution is introduced into the clay particles, they form maximum thickness of diffusive double layer. Thickness of DDL. While as you increase the valency, for example, if you look at the calcium, so this has a double valency. So in this case, the thickness of the diffusive double layer decreases. Thickness of the diffusive double layer decreases. Why? So this is very simple. If you take the net neutral charge on the each clay particle, that remains same. So this net neutral charge attracts equal or the amount of ions until its entire charge gets neutral. So here you can compare the valency in a sense. Single valency means a little weak person. A double valency means little stronger person. And as you increase the more and more valency, you are becoming more and more strength. Okay, so here you can annotate that if there are weak persons, more number of weak persons are getting attracted to the thickness of the diffusive double layer. As the persons are becoming more and more stronger, less number of persons are required to completely neutralize the charge. That means, so if you want to quantify, so as compared with the single valency, there are less number of double valency, the ions are available in the thickness of the diffusion double layer. So this is what is the influence of the valency. As the valency increases, there is a reduction in the thickness of the diffusion double layer. As the valency increases, there is a reduction in the thickness of the double layer. Now, when you talk about the ionic strength, so the ionic strength is represented in terms of the molarity. So you can talk about 1 molar, 1 molar, 2 molar, 0.1 molar, so on and so forth. So we cannot say a particular trend about the molarity or ionic strength. It again depends upon how much they could able to attract. So for example, at 1 molar, if the availability of the sodium ions are rich, so they can form the maximum thickness of the diffusive double layer. But if the molarity keeps on increased, or if so it gets saturated. So at that time, there may not be any kind of influence of the molarity and the thickness of the diffusive double layer, because you are already satisfying the charge, or you are already neutralizing the charge available on the clay surfaces. So that is the reason. So the molarity also influences, but so there is no specific trend. That again depends upon the kind of the ionic solution that you introduce into the soil media. Okay, so this is influence of ionic strength, influence of the valency. So then what next? Then you may also see there is a influence of the temperature. Influence of the temperature and the thickness of the diffusive double layer. So all these formations of the diffusive double layer generally happens at ambient temperature. Suppose if you increase the temperature, the obvious consequence is they will try to evaporate the water molecules. Whenever there is a elevated temperature, more and more, so more is the evaporation. When there is a more evaporation, obviously there is a reduction in the thickness of the diffusible layer. So this is how we can connotate the influence of the temperature on the thickness of the diffusible layer. Okay, so this is the influence of the temperature. There may be other phenomena also, so just look into it. But fundamentally, so if we can able to understand so the whole concept of what do you mean with the diffusible layer, what are the different parameters that are influencing everything, so that is good. Okay, now, so this understanding is critical, so in a sense, to understand the soil behavior. My first thing is that if you recall the concepts of the soil mechanics, there is no such formation of the diffusible layer and the sand particles. Suppose say this is a sand particle. So on sand particle, we cannot able to anticipate or expect any such kind of the formation of the diffusible layer. Okay, so that means the formation of the DDL is typically valid only for the clay particles, so none other particles. So since in case of the sand, there is no formation of the diffusible layer, so we don't need to talk about that thing. But let us try to understand. Suppose say you take your consistency graph. So what is on x-axis and what is on y-axis, the consistency graph?
So x-axis moisture content.
So x-axis is moisture content and y-axis?
Plasticity index.
Volume.
Specific volume.
Number of.
Consistency graph. I think specific volume, na?
Yes, sir.
So your y-axis is the specific volume, x-axis is the water content. So if you try to draw the relationship, so it is constant up to a certain extent, then increases. Okay, so as you start adding water to the soil mass, until certain extent, that is typically presented as what limit it is?
Shrinkage limit.
Now if you keep on adding the water, so behind the shrinkage limit, there is an increase in the volume. There is an increase in the volume. So now, once if you keep on adding the water, what happens after shrinkage limit? What is the next limit?
Plastic limit.
Plastic limit, sir.
Thereafter?
Sir, liquid limit.
Liquid limit. Okay. So the very first comes is shrinkage limit, thereafter plastic limit, thereafter liquid limit. Now let us look at. Initially, I have taken a constant volume of the soil mass. What I have done, I have keep on added the water. That is, just increase the volume of water which has been added to the same soil mass. But how come there is an increase in the volume? How do you understand? So this increase in volume with respect to addition of the water.
So I think as the water enters into the pore, so the they become loose. That's why the volume is increases.
Okay. Others.
Hydration increases.
Pardon me? Can you repeat? Yeah.
Here increases volume of intermolecular space.
Okay, any other logical answer?
hydration increases.
Hydration increases.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, at the sinkage limit, the soil mass becomes saturated, and further increase in water content will increase the volume by water only, sir.
Increase the volume by water only. But my question is, how that volume increment is happening? That's what is my very basic question.
Sir, displacement of soil, solid mass, soil particles by water.
But how the displacement is happening?
Sir, there's, as one said, that there is expansion. The particles become more distant from each other.
But how that is happening?
I don't know.
Sir, when we wait, add water, then clay particle get displaced due to the diffuse double layer.
Okay. So we can correlate the entire volume change to the formation. See, first when you start adding the water to the soil mass, so this is the soil sample or soil mass, whatever you say. What is happening initially? So initially we have taken with the dry soil. So the all initial water that you are adding will simply fill all the voids. So filling of voids. So once all the voids got filled, that's what we call as the completely or complete saturation. Complete saturation. Even if you look at the very definition of the degree of saturation, so it is volume of water upon volume of the voids. So at this point, all volume of voids are occupied with the volume of water. So therefore, it is fully saturated. The sample is fully saturated. So whenever the sample is completely saturated, that limit is called as a shrinkage limit. So if you look at the very basic definition of the shrinkage limit, it is the water content up to which there was no change in the volume of the soil sample. And if you look at graph carefully, it is simply filling only the voids. There is no change in the volume. The graph is almost perfect horizontal. Okay. Now, behind plastic limit, so you can hypothesize that now, after filling the voids, after all the voids got filled, now the additional water started forming, so the diffuse double layer on each and every clay particle. But the amount of the water may be not sufficient to form DDL, diffuse double layer, on each and every clay particle. So wherever the water molecules can get able to adhere onto the soil particle or clay particle, so they will start forming. So when there is a formation of the partial diffuse double layer, they started repelling the particles, or they started displacing the particles apart. When this displacement occurs, so that's what normally we designate as increase in the volume change. So that's what we call as a volume change. However, although the volume change started at shrinkage limit, but what is the significance of the plastic limit? Because post shrinkage limit, so there is a continuous increase in the volume. Now what we are doing is simply mechanically adding the water, but in between we are saying that the soil has attained the state of the plastic limit. What do you mean by that plastic limit?
Sir, it is the water content at which the soil is crumble while making a thread of 3 mm.
Well, that's okay. That is a bookish definition. So, and that is experimental. Because, so you know theoretically something is happening. So, we have to prove experimentally. So, then we have done some kind of experimentation in the laboratory. So, we found that the plastic limit water content is approximately meets where the soil becomes the crumb limit. Okay, but that's what I'm not asking. I'm asking the very fundamental question.
Water content at which the soil failed to behave plastically, plasticity properties.
Okay, so this is some logical answer. The plastic limit is starting or the plastic limit is ending?
Sir, ending.
Right?
Starting.
So plastic limit is starting.
Okay,
sir. Sir, semi-solid property is ending.
Ah, okay. So you can say
it is just start now.
Semi-solid. So here the plastic limit indicates that the soil now started acting as a plastic material. Got it? Your plastic limit indicates the soil started acting now as a plastic material. But what does that mean? When the soil is in the semi-solid state, so there is increase in the volume, but however, the soil is so tough or so hard, we can't expect not much change in the volume. Suppose if you take the soil so into your palm and if you press it, you find that it is so hard, we can't able to press it. You can't able to see any kind of a deformation or dent in the soil until the soil attains the state of plastic limit. The moment it reaches to the plastic limit, now we can see that it is deforming. Okay, plastic, irrespective of your subject, the same plastic you also read in your transportation engineering, structural engineering or any other engineering. Plastic state means any material or body started deforming permanently without any recovery. If it is in the state of recovery, that we call as elastic. So here plastic means now if you apply some force at the plastic limit or behind the plastic limit, it undergoes some amount of the plastic deformation. That means permanent deformation. While here in case of the soil, we say that so this is the point wherein the soil started behaving like the plastic material and it started undergoing the permanent deformation. So how long it exhibits such plasticity characteristics? So until the increase in the water content is equals to the plasticity index, which is defined as liquid limit minus plastic limit. So what is the significance of this liquid limit?
Sir, after liquid limit, soil will behave like liquid and it will have a shear strength of 2.7 megapascal.
Okay, so will it behave like a real liquid?
No, sir.
See, liquid means it behaves like a water, but will it really behave like a water?
No, won't.
And how come?
No, specific, we can relate with the specific gravity also, sir. Liquid have, means water have specific gravity one, but when we mix the water with soil, the specific gravity is more than one, sir. So it will not behave like a, just water.
Okay, so good.
Sir, here liquid means it will not resist any load.
So can you just reframe the same terminology? You said the right answer. You said the right answer, but can you just reframe the terminology?
For liquid, there won't be shear strength, but here there is some shear strength.
Forget about all these shear strength concepts, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so try to understand the very fundamental way. Because those are some kind of indications. So the significance of this liquid limit is that behind liquid limit, behind liquid limit, it is almost in slurry state. It will be converted from plastic to the slurry. And this slurry started flowing independently without requirement of any additional force. That's what is the significance of liquid limit. Okay, so why we call it as a limit? Because these are some form of the boundary of the water content. While these limits are not same for any two given soils, so they depend on lot of parameters. So that is out of context. So if you can able to understand what is the relevance between the formation of the diffusive double layer, how it implicates the change in the volume of the soil sample, that is the first and foremost important. Then what is the physical meaning of shrinkage limit, liquid limit, plastic limit, plasticity index, so on and so forth. There are other liquid, other consistency limits are there. So now, once having explained this much, having understood this much, now you can make a correlation between the other consistency limits and their physical significance. Okay, so if you have any questions, you are most welcome to ask right now.
Sir, can you please repeat diffusion layer while changing the volume?
See, until shrinkage limit, so all of the voids in the soil sample got filled with the water. Okay, so that's why there is no change in the volume of the soil sample. But even after filling of all the voids, if you are still adding the water, where this water will go? Either it has to come outside from the soil sample, but that will not happen because the clay particles has a negative charge. So this negative charge will try to get neutralized by attracting the positive ions. So when you are adding the water, what water comprises? What is the composition of water? H2O molecule. Okay, it is H2O molecule. So this negative charge, so it doesn't bother about whether they are available in the form of ions or the molecules. Whatever available, it tries to get attract and try to neutralize itself. So therefore, since you are introducing the molecules into the system as a pore water, all these molecules simply get adhered onto the clay surface. Once there is a formation of this diffusive double layer, just try to understand now. Suppose this also typical diagram which you might have seen. So this is the formation of the diffusive double layer. Now if I see another clay particle, so this is the formation of the another diffusive double layer. So this is total twice the thickness of the diffusive double layer. So 2 multiplied by DDL. So DDL from one particle and DDL from another particle. Okay. Now here there are two things. Suppose they can repel each other. They can get attracted each other. So when this repulsion occurs, when this attraction occurs,
the likely charge repel and unlikely charge.
Okay, very good. Next.
It will repel up to the point it doesn't got completely neutralized.
That's okay. But when they started getting repelled or when they started getting attracted, under what circumstance, in a more realistic way? See, there should be some situation. Suppose say here, you take only this consistency limits graph. So when you are increasing the volume, or the specific volume is increasing, so is there a repulsion or is there attraction?
Repulsion,
repulsion,
sir.
Repulsion. Okay. So repulsion. Why repulsion? Because there is a more and more formation of diffusive layer on the clay particles. Now you may ask a question: is it really possible when I compare this with the sand particles? Just imagine, if you take the specific surface area, the specific surface area of a sand and of a clay, What is the specific surface area of the sand particles?
B by 6.
Approximate value. It is approximately less than 1 or 0.1 square meter. And what is the specific surface of the clay particle?
So 400, 800.
So it ranges from 50 to 800 square meter. So just imagine how significant difference in the specific surface area between sand and clay. 0.1 square meter means very few particles are there in 1 gram of the soil sample. But if you take the clay, in 1 gram of the soil, there are numerous number of the clay particles. So if you take 1 gram of the clay particle, you can spread over an area of 50 square meters to 800 square meter. Where is the 0.1 square meter and where is the 800 square meter? So this 800 square meter is almost equivalent to 1 football stadium. That means if you take 1 gram of, say, montmorillonite, which can be spread evenly over an area of the football stadium, such are the number of particles can exist in 1 gram of the sample. So if such many number of particles are available in 1 gram, so don't you think such amount of water they could able to attract? Such is the amount of the charge, and such could be the formation of the diffusive double layer. So try to understand the intensity by relating your specific surface area with the formations of the diffusive double layer. So you may argue that the thickness of the diffusive double layer may be in terms of the angstroms or the nanometers or the microns. But if that number of microns are multiplied with this big number, then you can come up with really a potential value. So that's how we can able to correlate. That's how one can able to anticipate volume change in the expansive soil or in any clay material, or the reverse is consolidation. So the consolidation is not valid for the sand, but as these clay particles would able to attract immense amount of water, so when this water all gets expelled out, so then they are bound to show some kind of the compressibility, that is called as a consolidation. So when there is an increase in the volume, so because of the complete formation of the diffusive double layer, so there is a repulsion between the particles. On the other hand, the opposite of the displacement is contraction. So this contraction or the attraction happens when the water in the diffusive double layer gets evaporated. So this process is called as a shrinkage. When there is a volume change, volume increment, there is a repulsion that happens between the clay particle. When there is a shrinkage, when there is a shrinkage in the soil mass, maybe because of the maybe when it is exposed to elevated temperature, or maybe because of the expulsion of the water, so then the particles started coming close. That is called as a attraction. When they come close, we call them as attraction. When they repel each other, we call it as a displacement. They move away, it is called as a displacement. So this attraction and displacement happens over huge number of soil particles or clay particles. That's why the clay could able to exhibit such amount of the consolidation or the compressibility, such amount of the swelling potential, or otherwise volume change. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, any questions?
In the clay particle, there are negative charges in the faces and positive in the end. So what happens to the end? Is there any clay particle attached to the end?
Yeah, that's why you read na face to face, edge to edge connection. You have read about the face to face clay particle connection, edge to edge, or face to edge, so on and so forth. All those because of this negative charges. Okay, so now let us little deep dive into the clay mineralogy only. Now, as in the initial time, we were talking about different clay. Yeah.
So in clay particle, they are participated only by phase, no sir. So then, what about the middle one, sir? Middle part of the clay, they are not taking place any. Finish.
Middle part phase?
Means like, sir, between the edge phases.
Oh, between the edges. No, this is the edge, this is the surface.
So, between the surface, sir.
Here?
Yes, sir.
No, here, see, first of all, okay. So, first of all, what is that? Actually, that is solid material. Actually, that part I'm coming to now. So, let me discuss about that part. Yeah, any other question? So, before I answer the question. Anybody has any question?
So it is solid, so how can diffuse layer can be formed inside that? So it can be formed around this particle.
Yeah, there is no formation of diffuse double layer inside the particle because inside is a solid.
Yes, sir.
It is only on the surrounding surface, as you said, right? Good. So, any other questions? Okay. So now, we are talking about different clay minerals like kaolinite, illite, and montmorillonite. You also know the clay mineral structure. So, suppose if I take kaolinite. So how the clay mineral structure looks like for this? For kaolinite? For the clay mineral structure?
Sir, it is 1:1 mineral in which a gibbsite sheet and a superficial
bathing. 1:1 is okay. What is this 1:1? What is 1 and what is 1?
The one gibbsite sheet is joined with 1 silica sheet binding to 5 hydrogen.
So 1 gibbsite and what is second one?
The silica sheet.
Oh, silica sheet. Yeah. So here, just correct me. So first there is a silica sheet and there is a aluminium sheet, then again there is some interface between these two, and again there is a gibbsite sheet and there is a silica sheet. These are right? This is silica, gibbsite, silica. And these two are interconnected by
iron.
What kind of ions?
Hydrogen bonding.
Okay. So that is H2O bonding.
The silica is for the silica should be above the gibbsite for
okay, you just correct yourself. I just have drawn as per her recommendation. So okay, so you just correct yourself. Now this is 1:1 sheet, and there is something also called as 1:2 sheet. Suppose if I take the montmorillonite, what about the montmorillonite? How it looks like?
So there is a gibbsite sheet sandwiched between two silica sheets.
Between two silica sheet?
There is one gibbsite.
Is it between two silica or between silica is sandwiched between two gibbsite?
The gibbsite is sandwiched between two silica sheets.
Can you please check it once? Others?
Two silica, sir.
Yes, sir. Sorry.
So you mean to say, so this is silica, or this is gibbsite. Is that right? So just correct me. These are right now.
Yes, sir.
So this is silica, gibbsite, silica, gibbsite, silica. So in between, what is there?
Sir, water bond.
Here also water bond.
No, sir. In the first case, we have hydrogen bond.
The van der Waals bond.
What is the difference between water bond and hydrogen bond?
Sir, in between water and some ion, sir.
This weak van der Waals.
Van der Waals force.
Is weak van der Waals plus exchangeable cations. Okay, so van der Waals force is related to which cation or anion? It is related to oxygen. Okay, just check it. So weak oxygen plus interconnected by hydrogen bonding, while in case of the montmorillonites, the seeds are connected by van der Waal plus exchangeable cation. While in case of illite, what is that bonding type? In case of illite, what is the bonding type?
Potassium bond.
Is the potassium bond. It is the potassium bond. Now, we can discuss about the Clayman-Dalzy for whole semester. It's not required. It's because there are a lot of subjects are available. If you look at the ceramic technology or couple of the subjects of the metallurgy. Many of these subjects deal with colloidal particles. These are all part of the colloidal particles. But for us, we need to have a big understanding about a few of the minerals. Among them, majority are kyanite, illite, montmorillonite, mica, fluorite, atta, pulgate, so on and so forth. So around 10 minerals normally we deal with. Okay, now, this is a silica seed, this is a gibbsite seed. So, do you understand how this silica seed is formed? This gibbsite seed is formed? And how the silica is attached to the gibbsite? What is the crystal structure of silicate or silica?
Tetrahedron.
How do you represent this one? Tetrahedron. So this is is it okay or something else?
Okay, sir.
So at the middle there is silica, at the edge there is a oxygen. So how do you read this one? One silica atom is attached to four oxygen atoms. Alright? One silica is attached to four oxygen. And what about aluminium? That is gibbsite. What kind of structure it is?
This is octahedral.
Octahedral. So how do you represent that? So how many oxygen are there total? 6 or 8?
8.
So just correct yourself. In between is aluminium, so oxygen. Is this correct? So one aluminium is connected with 8 oxygen ions. Is it correct?
Sir, one aluminium is attached with 6 hydroxyl ions.
6
hydroxyl ions.
I did not hear. Your voice is not clear. One aluminium is connected to 6 hydroxyl. Hydrogen.
Hydroxyl. OH. OH.
No, they are not hydroxyls. They are oxygen only. Hydroxyls are different. Check it once. Okay, so this is the crystal structure of silica and this is the crystal structure of aluminum. Now here one interesting thing that you need to understand is this is tetrahedron and this is the octahedron. Now let us look at the edge of the oxygen. Now, is this the oxygen is free in terms of the charge or in terms of the valency? Is it completely neutralized?
Yes, sir.
So one is left now. One.
Yeah. So it is, there is some valency. It's not complete. There are some electron valency or something. Or other way round of understanding this one is, this can always be attached with the other silica ion. Okay, so this can be attached with other silica atom, other silica atom. So the process continues. So this is how a silica seed will be formed. Okay, so if there is no imprints, so the formation of the seed is continuous in an indefinite way. What you can do, you can break at any point of time. Okay. So if you break, one oxygen gets exposed to the atmospheric condition. Well, similarly, I can annotate the same thing to octahedral structure also. So these four outer oxygen atoms, oxygen ions, can be attached to another, the aluminum crystal structure. So that means this can also form another seed, which is typically represented in the form of a gibbsite. Okay, now you could able to understand why this is a rhomboidal structure, why this is a rectangle. The rectangle is because, so you just imagine there is another tetrahedral structure and this oxygen is commonly shared by two aluminium. So if you keep one adjacent to another, one adjacent to another, that forms a seat. This seat is called as a gibbsite seed, while this seed is called as a silica seed. Now there is another thing also. For example, this is oxygen. So this oxygen can also be shared by your gibbsite seed. Can also be shared by gibbsite seed. So this is a common between silica and aluminium. So here I am saying, okay, so this is oxygen, this is oxygen, this is oxygen, this is oxygen. Okay, so now a oxygen can be shared by either two silica atoms or one silica with one aluminum. One silica with one aluminum. Okay, so now, so it is clearly demonstrated how silica seed forms, how silica is attached to the gibbsite. So these two are one seed, or this is called as I think one layer. So this is silica seed and this is gibbsite seed. Together they'll be called as one layer, if I'm not wrong. Just check your books. One layer. So two layers are interconnected by hydrogen bonding. If it is hydrogen bonding, then the clay mineral is called as a kyanite. If two layers are interconnected with the potassium bonding, that clay mineral is called as illite. If two layers are interconnected by weak van der Waal force plus exchangeable cations, that is called as a montmorillonite. All right. So this is how different clay minerals are distinguished, and this is how we can able to understand the formation of the silica seed and the formation of the gibbsite seed. So if anybody has any question, please ask me. So don't hesitate. So I'm not
here. Sir, in gibbsite, sir, in gibbsite, it should be OH minus in place of oxygen, then it will form hydrogen bond. It should be hydroxyl.
Should be hydroxyl.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so then correct it accordingly. The C is also saying the same hydroxyl. But if it is hydroxyl, then how do you attach silicate with the gibbsite?
Sir, silicate have one negative ion connected with silicon and other oxygen negative ion is free. It will attach with OH minus. Yes, sir. Got it, sir.
Fine, fine. So now I made you understand the fundamental. Now it is up to you, whatever the interconnections and logics you make it. Okay. So now, there are other two things that you need to understand. One is, I was talking about how the negative charge imparted on the clay particle. So that's we call the isomorphous substitution. Now what do you mean by the isomorphous substitution? See, here silica is available. If the silica can be replaced with aluminum ions. Just remember, this exchange is happening or the replacement is happening at the crystal structure level. So if it happens at crystal structure level, that replacement is called as a isomorphous substitution. Now on the other hand, let us look into the diffusible layer. So initially, so I'm assuming that this is a sodium ion. Let me draw it. So this is the clay surface. There is a negative charge and attracting the positive ions. So I'm assuming these are initially attracted with the positive sodium cations. Now what I have done, I have replaced sodium with the calcium. So there is a negative charge. And now there are cations, but these cations have replaced sodium cations. Now, where this replacement has occurred and where this replacement has occurred? So in case of replacement between silica and alumina, so this has happened at crystal structure level. Therefore, it is called as an isomorphous substitution. On the other hand, so the replacement of sodium with the calcium has happened on the surface of the clay particle. So this replacement is called as a cation exchange capacity. There is something also called as the anion exchange. So cation exchange or anion exchange. If the replacement happens between the anions, it is called as the anion exchange. If the replacement happens between the cations, it is called as a cation exchange capacity. Okay, so now I hope it is clear to you now what is the difference between isomorphous substitution and what is cation exchange capacity. So now his question also answered. So what happens between this negative charge? Nothing happens. That is the body of the clay particle. Nothing can able to ingress into the crystal structure level except replacement of the atoms. Now when the replacement happens, so suppose silica has a 3 or 4 valency.
4.
Just imagine when higher valency is replaced by the lower valency, there is some negative charge left over. That negative charge is designated to negative charge on the clay surface. This is the one rule. While there may be other things also happening. But this is the one of the way of imparting negative charge onto the clay surface.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I have general doubt. Sir, silica have valency of 4 and oxygen have -2 valency. So how contain 4 oxygen in silica?
You are asking about this crystal structure?
Yes, sir. So it is participated by 4 oxygen, but silica have only 4 plus. So it will contain only 2 oxygen now, because it satisfy only 2 oxygen. SiO2, sir.
That nature has done it. We have not done anything. So this formation of tetrahedral is nature's process. We haven't done anything in between. How they have
existed? Also, in aluminium there is 3 valence.
I cannot be able to answer it because I am not expert of the chemistry. So rather you have to see some material chemistry book or something. I don't have any ready-made answer right now. Your question is correct, but I can answer your question in a different way. So once this is clear, then I can answer that other question.
Sir, one thing, isomorphous substitution occur in form of crystal, no, sir? Like when
no, it is exchanging? It happens inside the crystal structure. This entire thing is called as a particle, that is silica crystal. This is single silica crystal. This is single aluminum crystal.
Okay, sir.
And what is the size of this crystal? Or what is the size of these layers? They are in nano size. Okay. Even suppose if I take the entire thickness of the 2 layers, so this I think is some angstroms.
In some 7 angstrom or 10 angstrom.
Yeah, 7 angstroms or 10 angstroms. Now if you compare different clay minerals, so the smallest or the least thickness is possible for the montmorillonite. So the layer thickness is least in case of the montmorillonite. That's why its surface area is very large.
Sir, only aluminium is responsible for isomorphous substitution. Now other ion is also possible.
No. It can happen with any other atoms or any other cations. Need not be only with aluminium. It can happen with anything. Okay. Now let us come to having understood the very fundamentals of the chemistry or the structure of the clay minerals, let us try to correlate. So how they imply, means these change in crystal structure or the change or the difference in the valency or difference in the charge on the water holding capacity of different particles. Now first let me take the sand particle. Sand particle. So this is a little bit spherical shape sand particle. Now suppose if I take this as a sand particle, so first of all there is no formation of the diffusive double layer on the sand particle. Okay, this is confirmed, this is proved just now. But still, can we say that there is no adherence of water molecules on a sand particle? Can we outrightly discard that no water adheres onto the sand particle? Come on.
I think van der Waals forces can act here.
Okay. So suppose if I take these sand particles and I dip it in it becomes a wet. That means some amount of the water adhere onto the sand particle. But how this is possible? We can say this is some monolayer of water molecules. Monolayer of H2O. But how this adherence of the monolayer of water on the sand particle is possible?
So surface tension.
Surface tension, okay. But where the surface tension is happening? Usually surface tension happens between two particles, na? If I am not wrong, you present your surface tension with, suppose this is the sand particle and this is the water and sediment. So this is another sand particle and this is another water layer. So this is the interconnected water. So this exerts the tension that exerts between two particles. So this is called as surface tension. In fact, the same surface tension also exists in clay particles, doesn't matter. But why? What is the rationale behind formation of this monolayer? So look into your tetrahedral structure, then you can able to understand. So nothing to do with the soil particle, sorry, particle. It's always something to do with the chemistry. So what is the leftover charge on the sand particle or the silica tetrahedral?
Oxygen, sir. It's a 4 minus 4.
Okay, so suppose this is this is the sand particle. So leftover is oxygen. So this is 2 minus. Okay, now this can be connected to Can it be connected to water molecule? Savi Katsai, are you there?
Yes, sir.
But you're not speaking anything. I haven't heard from your mouth at all. Pallavi.
Yes, sir.
What is happening?
It can be connected to the hydrogen. Hydrogen. Adhering hydrogen.
Hydrogen? Okay. So this can be connected to one hydrogen or another hydrogen. Okay, so the combination of two hydrogen with one oxygen can become the water molecule. So a common oxygen can be shared by water molecule and the sand particle. Okay, so a common oxygen can be shared by water molecule and the silica, the sand particle. However, so the oxygen bond is said to be weakest bond among all the bonds. So that is van der Waal bond. So van der Waal bond is weakest among all the bonds. So which bond is the strongest?
Hydrogen bond.
Hydrogen bond. Hydrogen is the strongest. Oxygen is the weakest. So here it is, the bonding is with the help of the oxygen. So therefore it is very weak. Very weak bonding. That's why we can simply rub off the water from the sand particle, because the bonding is so weak. Okay, so this is the reason. So as oxygen ions are shared by water molecules and the silica tetrahedral, so we can envisage the formation of a monolayer. There may be another layers of oxygen, say, water molecules. There may be possibility, because one H2O can be attached to the another. One H2O can be attached with the another. So until again they fulfill the principle of the charge neutrality. But the answer, the question is that here the attraction cannot continue like a clay particle, where the charge deficiency is significantly high, so as compared with the sand particle. So that's why the thickness of the diffusion double layer is always much, much higher than the thickness of the monolayer of the hydrogen ions on the sand particles. Okay, so now is it clear to everyone why the clay holds the water, why the sand particles or the gravel particles will not hold the water, or any other questions still? Okay, so because of this chemistry, so even if we add any water to sand, they simply go and fill only the voids. Thereafter, you cannot able to see any kind of a volume change, which we have seen in the case of the fine grain soils in the form of a consistency chart. So these are the very fundamentals that you must remember for your entire life, because when you design any structure on a sand or on a clay material, you must try to correlate. So if that particular soil is exhibiting some kind of a abnormal phenomenon, say for example more consolidation than the anticipated, or more active or passive earth pressure than the anticipated, more seepage than the anticipated, more permeability than the anticipated, or less shear strength or the more shear strength than the anticipated. So all these things are highly interconnected with the very basic chemistry at particulate level. Okay, so these are all called as a micro level interactions. However, this micro level is extrapolated to macro behavior of the soil overall. So in a sense, so we as a complete human body, but inside our human body, so a lot of phenomena are happening. The moment you consume the food, our digestion system is digesting and giving the energy. So thereby our body is getting the energy. So internally at micro level digestion is happening, but at macro level we as a human being are behaving. So similarly in case of the soil also, so at micro level some phenomena are happening, but their implication of the reflection as a overall of that particular material is called as a soil behavior. Is called as a soil behavior. Okay, so having understood this much, so I need to give a little bit introduction about the other clay minerals. So about the sand, that is good enough. Nothing more than is required. So now among the different clay minerals, so you have read in your soil mechanics that so clay mineral like a kaolinite or the hillite, they are not expansive. So they are not expansive. So that means they do not undergo volume change. While when you talk about the montmorillonite, it is called as a expansive mineral. That means the volume change happens the moment you introduce the water into the particles. Now try to understand. Kaolinite is a 1:1 mineral. Illite is 1:2 mineral. Montmorillonite is a 1:2 mineral. Now suppose if I take the particle as a whole. So let me take the particle as a whole. So this is particle as a whole. So regardless of the illite or montmorillonite, so there is a negative charge. So this is, there is a negative charge all around the surface. So this negative charge attracts the positive charge, thereby it forms the diffusive double layer. Okay, so this is diffused double layer. Now this formation of the diffusive double layer could be remain same between illite or the montmorillonite as the particle, as a whole of the particle. Okay, but there is something internally which happens only in case of the montmorillonite. That's because of the van der Waals force or exchangeable cations. While in case of the illite, the bonding between these two is kyanite, which is so strong, this kyanite bonding doesn't allow separation of the layers. Doesn't allow the separation of the layers. So therefore, whatever the formation of the diffusive double layer that happens all surrounding the soil particle alone, only. This is the reason you are seeing the volume change regardless of the clay type in consistency chart. So this is specific volume. So regardless of the clay particle type, this volume increment, the consistency chart is valid. But there is something which is only valid for the montmorillonites, swelling behavior. Swelling behavior. Now how such swelling behavior is happening? So in case of the montmorillonite. So that is happening. So because of the weak van der Waal force, that is with the oxygen plus exchangeable cations. Suppose if I take again this cross section. Suppose if you take this cross section, so this is oxygen bonding. So this is so weak, it allows separation of the upper layer with the bottom layer. And moreover, the exchangeable means here exchange of the sodium plus or the calcium 2 plus or the potassium plus or silica 4 plus. So there is possibility of replacement of exchangeable ions between the top and the bottom layers. When the exchange happens, there is a possibility of the separation of upper layer with the bottom layer, the separation. While this separation is completely absent in any other type of the clay minerals, but exclusively valid only in case with the montmorillonite. Okay, and this separation is in addition to the formation of the diffusive double layer as a particle whole. This is very critical. This separation of the top layer and bottom layer is exclusive to montmorillonite, and which is in addition to the diffusive double layer, which is formed on the clay part, on the top layer and the bottom layer. Now here in case of this one, there are two things. There is a formation of the diffusive double layer. So there is a formation of the diffusive double layer, and there is a separation of the layers. So this is a one diffusive double layer. So diffusive double layer caused some volume change. Now this is second. Separation also caused some volume change. So this separation volume change is in addition to the volume change of the DDM. So this volume change is reflected in the form of a swelling. So is reflected in the form of a swelling. Okay, swelling is nothing but volume change. Swelling is nothing but volume change. Now, if anybody is asked, or if you refer to any of the papers, montmorillonite exhibits swelling or the volume change phenomenon. It is demonstrated very well now. It's because of the separation of the layers. While the third, which additionally happens in case of montmorillonite, is separation of seeds. Separation of seeds. Separation of layers and separation of the seeds. So if the separation of layers happens, that is called as a primary swelling, we can say primary volume change. Primary swelling. If the separation also occurs at the seeds level, that is called as a secondary or crystalline volume change, crystalline structure. Secondary or intercrystal or intercrystalline swelling, primary or secondary. Also called as crystalline swelling. So crystalline swelling. Okay. Now, so try to understand carefully. So the separation is happening because of the weak van der Waal force plus exchange of the cations. So therefore, the swelling is always because of the exchange of the ions. So that's why if you refer to any book or any paper, they simply say the swelling is attributed to exchange of ions or because of the cation exchange capacity. That is a replacement of one ion with the another ion on the particle surface, not at the crystal structure level. So there is a third step, that is separation of the strains. And so this also causes additional swelling. So in case of the montmorillonite, the volume change is primarily because of the three phenomena. One is the formation of the diffuse double layer. Second thing is separation of the layers. The third thing is separation of the seeds. Okay. So any questions?
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in clay particle, there is negative charge. So that's why it's a diffuse layer form. But sir, here you can see that there is a silica crystal which projects charge, sir. So how does it form, sir, here?
I'm sorry, I did not get your question.
Sir,
there is
means, sir, in clay particle on surface there is negative charge, so that's why it attracts some positive charge and form diffusion layer until it separates ion, no, sir. Now in this montmorillonite there is a surface is silica layer or silica sheet, sir, and silica possesses positive charge, so how it make form, sir, diffusion layer, sir, because it have positive charge, na?
No, you are saying, see, this is the clay particle, na? This is the clay particle. When I say clay particle, it is a combination of everything. It cannot be a single silica seed or gibbsite seed. You cannot see in that aspect. This negative charge is because of the entire clay particle as a whole. You are looking at seed level. Seed level is only for your understanding. But external behavior is because of the entire combination.
Okay, sir. Means it is a montmorillonite is just one part of the clay layer, no, sir? Clay particle.
No, montmorillonite itself is a clay particle. It is not part. Montmorillonite itself is a clay particle.
And sir, another question. Sir, can we replace this Van der Waal with another bond so that this become also a good bond?
That's how we go for treatment now. So when people talk about treatment of expansive soil, what they do? So they will try to avoid this cation exchange replacement. They will try to remove this weak Van der Waal force by replacing with a strong Van der Waal force. So once it is replaced, now its entire structure got changed. So from swelling, it became a non-swelling. That's what is the meaning of the treatment. Treatment or stabilization of any expansive soil. Okay, so this is, see, when you go to doctor, what he will do? Will he directly prescribe the medicine or before that will he do something?
So we need to know the main problem.
Yeah, so based on the symptoms that you have explained to the doctor, what he does, he will say, you go to blood test. He will say, you go to X-ray, get it done. You go to some other department, get it done. So he collects all the diagnosis report and he tries to a common conclusion that, okay, so all these, whatever the symptoms that you are stated are matching with these diagnostic reports. So that means this entire thing is coming to a common disease of, say, X. Now this is the X which is confirmed based on the diagnosis. Now he will prescribe the required medicine. Okay, but for this entire thing to happen, it takes some time. So the moment you will go to doctor, he will not directly give any prescription. He will diagnose you, confirm that this is belongs to this disease. Then based on the diagnosis, so he will prescribe the medicine. So here also, unless otherwise you understand all these things, you cannot able to propose any kind of a remediation to the soil problem. Okay. And nowadays, it became an imperative to understand very micro level properties of any soil. So externally, whatever you have to understand, everything has been understood. There is no problem, which is completely got saturated. Okay, but what internal is happening? So because of the temperature change, because of the external rainfall, or because of the excessive loading, how it changes the micro level behavior so that we can take some kind of the remedial action. Say, for example, without having understood all these things, if somebody said that this soil is showing the lesser shear strength, can you try to improve the shear strength without having understood all these things? No way. Okay, it's not possible. So what I mean to say is, so this kind of all understanding is some kind of a diagnosis on the soil part. Because every time we cannot diagnose, we cannot say that, so this is happening. But still we diagnose. So in a sense, the moment we collect the soil sample, we try to establish its consistency limits. We try to establish its compaction characteristics. If we want, then we also do some kind of the chemical analysis. What kind of the oxide compositions of the soil particle? What are the mineralogical compositions? How much is the clay content? How much is the sand content? Then we try to correlate the engineering property with all these properties. A simple example is, somebody has reported a liquid limit of say 100, but he has reported only 10% of clay content. Now, is it possible really?
No, sir.
Why? How can you say that it is not?
Sir, it is possible, but we need to know which type of mineral it contains.
Okay. So one answer is, okay, there may be a possibility, but I need to know what kind of the mineral it is. Now you have established that, so it contains illite. Now what is your answer? So you diagnosed and found that it is an illite mineral. So now what would be your answer?
Sir, I didn't understand your question, sir. Can you repeat, please?
Okay, so my simple question is, somebody has reported a liquid limit of 100 to a soil which contained only 10% of clay fraction. So how do you justify this one? Is it possible or not possible? If possible, how can you justify? If it is not possible, how can you justify? So this is the engineering. Try to understand. This is why teaching is required. Otherwise, everybody might be reading the books which are available in the library. So the videos or the audios which are available in the YouTube. But nobody explains, nobody talks about all these kind of the problems. And without understood, so without making any kind of a comments on such a kind of the problems, you cannot become a good civil engineer or the geotechnical engineer. Okay, so just think of about all these things. So what I will do, I will stop it here only now. So maybe we'll meet on next Tuesday at 11 o'clock. Okay, so go through all the fundamentals one more time. If you have any questions, you are most welcome to ask them.
Sir, can you please suggest some reference books?
These are very fundamentals of the soil mechanics. You can refer to, but okay. So there is one book called as a Lamb and Whitman, so which talks about all fundamentals of the soil mechanics.